हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, टुडे वी विल डिस्कस सोडियम वेपर लैम्प। दिस क्लास इज यूजफुल फॉर इलेक्ट्रिकल स्टूडेंट्स फिफ्थ सेमेस्टर डिप्लोमा। सो डिप्लोमा स्टूडेंट्स दिस विल बी यूजफुल फॉर देम। सो इन आवर टुडेज क्लास वी विल डिस्कस अबाउट सोडियम वेपर लैम्प। ऑलरेडी इन आवर प्रीवियस क्लासेस वी हैव डिस्कस्ड अबाउट सम लैम्प्स, दैट इज फ्लोरोसेंट लैम्प्स एंड अदर लैम्प्स। So today we will discuss sodium vapor lamp. This is another important lamp which is frequently asked in your semester examination. So before going to its circuit diagram, let us understand its theory. So this lamp consists of a inner U-shaped glass tube which is made of high resistance glass and containing a small amount of metallic sodium. Neon gas and two electrodes, one anode and other cathode. So this is the basic construction features of this kind of lamp. So let us check its circuit diagram. So I will just zoom out so that we will have a clear view of this diagram in a single. Yes, here as you can see, there is a U-shaped glass. There is a anode, there is also a discharge tube student, vacuum tube is there and cathode is there. Now the cathode heating transformer is there, you can see, let me just point it out so that you can recall. This is the cathode heating transformer. Now for correction of power factor, or you can say for controlling the power factor, we have a capacitor. A choke is connected in series to the 230 volt AC supply. So the supply is AC. Now the diagram part is over, let us discuss its theory. So the inner tube is enclosed with an outer glass tube of U shape, and inner space between is evacuated to minimize the heat losses. Already we know that the inner space is evacuated to minimize the heat losses from the inner tube. The presence of neon gas serves to vaporize the sodium or produce sufficient heat. The glass tube is used in U-shape because long discharge paths are necessary. The lamp is used horizontally. This is very important, students. The lamp should be always used in horizontal position. It should not be used in a vertical position. So to help the sodium when spread along the tube. So for easy spreading of this sodium, this lamp should be always used in horizontal direction. Now, when supply is given to the lamp, the discharge take place in the neon gas. So when it is excited or it has been supplied to a source of AC voltage, the discharge take place in the neon gas first, and red orange glow produces. So you will observe there will be a change in color pattern. First you will observe there is a red orange glow. The metallic sodium gradually vaporizes and then ionizes, thereby producing a light of yellow color. So there will be a production of your yellow color. This lamp is also called as monochromatic lamp because it emits a light of yellow color of wavelength 5900 angstrom. So this light is also a monochromatic lamp. You should remember that this is also called as a monochromatic lamp. Which lamp? This sodium vapor lamp. The lamp takes about 5 to 6 minutes. So earlier these lamps were used, now these are discarded or backdated because of the fact that the power consumption is high. Also the other factor is the time duration which it takes for starting is considerably high. That is, it takes over 5 to 6 minutes during starting only, and takes about 15 minutes for coming in full brilliancy. That means it will take 15 minutes full so that it can glow to its full illuminated value. The luminous efficiency of the lamp is 50 lumens per watt, and its average life is about 300 working hours. So its working hour is 3000 working hours, and its efficiency, luminous efficiency is about 50 lumens per watt. So these are the important things which you should remember. Operating temperature of this lamp is about 300 degrees centigrade, and lamps are manufactured in the ratings of 40, 60, 80 and 140 watts. So according to your requirement, you can choose a particular type of wattage, and it can be installed at the desired place. Suppose your requirement of light is high, you will go, or you will choose a higher wattage lamp. If your wattage requirement is low, you can go for the lower wattage available lamps. Now the cathode heating transformer is used to send a high voltage of about 480 volt. So a considerably high amount of voltage is required during the starting, so a cathode heating transformer is utilized. So during the starting, only this 480 volt is produced, so that luminous discharge inside the tube take place. Under normal running condition, normal rated supply is given to lamp. Function of choke is to limit the current. So students, you should from here point out this important function of this choke and all those things which I will just I will tell you, that you should note it down and you should also remember them, because they are very essential. So these things are also in your lab classes. So for utilization, since it has been introduced in your fifth semester, the lab of this classes, that is utilization, or you can say workshop classes, you will have this kind of your sodium vapor lamp and other lamps you will be having in your lab laboratory classes, which will be in your sixth semester. So you, this thing you should remember, and the important thing which I am telling is you should note it down. So the function of the choke which I was discussing is very important. It is to limit the value of current, which tends to increase due to negative temperature resistance of the discharge path. The condenser is used to improve the power factor. So what is a condenser? It is basically a capacitor, right? And becomes as low as 0.3 due to choke and transformer. So due to choke and transformer, what are transformer and choke? They are basically inductance. So due to this high value of inductance, this power factor becomes very low, and it is of the range of 0.3. obviously it will be lagging. Why? Because we are using inductive circuits here. These lamps are suitable for only AC supply operation. You cannot use them in DC supply, because there this choke and this transformer concept will not work. So you have to use them in AC supply. These lamps are used for general outdoor lighting, highways where color distortion is not of much importance. These lamps are not suitable for indoor lighting. Also, if you will use in your indoor applications, there will be you will face eye vision problem, and also this amount of light will produce a glare, right? So these lights are not suitable for indoor purpose. It are those are best suited for your outdoor applications, especially highways, right? Now these lamps are not suitable for indoor lighting, as I told now. Moving to the next lamp, which is your mercury vapor lamp. This is also a very important lamp as far as your semester questions are concerned. So students, you will get out of these three, any two are must in a question paper, that is sodium vapor or mercury vapor, and from that side it is the incandescent bulb or your incandescent lamp or your that fluorescent tube, right? So this is also a very important lamp which is frequently asked in your semesters. So the operation of mercury vapor lamp and the fluorescent lamp is based on the excitation of atoms of some gaseous medium. It is worth mentioning that the frequency and the wavelength of the radiation given out by different atoms depends upon the level of their excitation. Obviously, it will depend upon their level of excitation. In case of mercury vapors alone, excitation to different level is possible. Some of the important wavelengths radiated by the excited mercury vapor atoms include 2537 AU, 1561 AU, 4358 AU, and also 4047 AU, and there are others also. So out of this wavelength, the first fall in UV range. So what is UV? This is ultraviolet range. The last three, being the visible spectrum, are given in blue, green, violet color sensation respectively. So other are in your visible range, so they are visible, but the first one is lying under your UV range. The first radiation is predominant in low pressure mercury vapor lamps working as fluorescent lamp. The last three are emitted in case of high pressure and about 1.5 atmospheric pressure to 5.10 atmospheric mercury vapor lamps. Its construction, let us discuss its construction also. The tube containing mercury vapor is made of hard glass. The outer glass protects the inner tube from coming into direct contact with atmospheric temperature. So to control the temperature or to make the inner wall protected, or you can also say the outer glass cover protects the inner tube from coming into direct contact to the atmosphere. So if it will be directly come into the contact of the atmosphere, what will happen? It will have, or it may be damaged. So the outer glass cover protects the inner tube from coming into direct contact with atmospheric temperature variation. It also absorbs ultraviolet radiations emitted from the lamp during working. Besides mercury, the inner tube consists of a percentage of argon gas. So it also contains a percentage of argon gas. There are two main electrodes made of tungsten wire and a starting electrode which is spaced quite close to one of the auxiliary electrodes. During connection of the supply mains, the auxiliary electrodes through a high series resistance along with the main electrode is connected to, say, neutral of the supply. The phase comes in the first main electrodes through the insulated part of the metallic cap. So this is the diagram, students. Just have a look. And this diagram you have to remember also. It's, you have to label the diagram also with its name. So try to remember this diagram. So you will find a metallic cap. There is a starting or heating transformer, you can say cathode heating transformer, or only a transformer you can say. There is a source of supply which is connected across a capacitor. There is a choke. Now there is the outer glass tube, vacuum, main electrodes, starting resistor, and auxiliary electrode. So these are the constructional features of your mercury arc lamp. Mercury vapor lamp, yes. Now let us go for its working. When the circuit is energized, the supply voltage appears between the main electrode. It is obvious when we will excite, or we will put it into the AC mains, what will happen? The supply will appear between the main electrodes marked 1, the starting or auxiliary electrode. The argon coming between these two electrodes is immediately ionized because distance between these two electrodes is very small, and a glow appears between the said electrodes. So there will be a glow produced. Right. So there will be a glow produced. Now the argon coming between this electrode is immediately ionized because the distance between these two electrodes is very small, and a glow appears between the said electrodes. A small current starts flowing through the starting resistance in series with the auxiliary electrode. This results in building up of pressure due to heating up of mercury, which is originally in the condensed form. Ultimately, the medium between the main electrode is ionized, and after it gets ionized, what will happen? Let us see. And the current starts flowing between the two. So there will be a conduction of current, or the current will start to flow between the two. It is no longer controlled by the high resistance of the starting circuit, but by the choke in the main circuit. So now the choke, The resistance of the ionized medium is much smaller, and the current chooses the low resistance path. The function of the capacitor is to improve the power factor of the circuit, which will otherwise be quite low due to the high inductance choke present in the circuit. Obviously, due to the presence of this choke, the power factor will fall drastically. So we have to improve the power factor, so we have to introduce capacitors. So here also you will find capacitors. The lamp discussed above is called MA type and is rated as 250 to 400 watts for AC mains voltage, that is 230 volt. There is some precaution, or you can say caution also. The lamp should be mounted vertically, so these lamps are vertically used, and your sodium vapor lamp are in horizontal. So you should remember which lamps are used in horizontally, which lamps are used in vertically. So this lamp, or your mercury vapor lamp, should be used in a vertical, or it can be mounted vertically, so that so that the inner tube can be damaged by the striking arc. Thus, considering the device unserviceable, this should be carefully considered. Now, the time taken during starting of the lamp is 5 to 6 minutes. Again, this type of lamp is also time consuming. This takes 5 to 6 minutes. The source will not start working again if the supply is once interrupted, till the pressure inside the inner tube subsides. The temperature inside the bulb remains approximately 650 degrees centigrade. So it is very, very, very hot. And the efficiency of the lamp is about 40 lumens per watt. If the choke is missing from the circuit, the current through the ionized medium will go on increasing beyond the control, thus permanently damaging the bulb. So suppose you try the bulb or this mercury vapor lamp, you try it without a choke, what will happen? So already, student, if you have remembered, I have said this choke is used for limiting the current. Right, you should understand also clearly that this will limit the current. If I will just bypass this choke, what will happen? High amount of current will be drawn. As a result, this lamp will be permanently damaged, and it cannot be repaired also, because these are very precisely made. So you should not use it without a choke. The color emitted by this lamp is bluish pale, which gives an unnatural appearance to the living objects. So its appearance are very unnatural. This make it suitable for indoor lighting, for industrial and other premises, despite its higher efficiency. Lastly, the lamp is suitable for AC supply only. So students, this kind of lamps are again used for your AC mains only. Mercury vapor lamp without choke. Another type of commercially purposed mercury vapor lamp is suitable for both AC as well as DC supply system. The major advantage of this lamp is the improvement of color over the given out by an ordinary MV lamp. What is MV? Mercury vapor lamps, which has been discussed a few moments ago, that is discussed earlier. In this case, the current is controlled by a series tungsten filament which glows beside the light emitted from mercury tube. Consequently, the shortage of red color in the light is so emitted is compensated and quality of the light is improved. So here is the diagram. You can see there is a supply, AC or DC, both we can supply. We can connect to a AC source or a DC source also. What else is there? There is a thermal switch. There is a main electrode. There is also a glass, outer glass cover, electrode, and your tungsten filament. Right. Let us move. Lumens per watt and the power factor is 0.65. A still more recent development in mercury lamps is an ultra pressure lamp operating at about 40 atmosphere and has an efficiency comparable with the sodium vapor lamps. These lamps are used for outdoor and industrial lightings. Now we will discuss about fluorescent lamp, student. This is also a very important one. So let us discuss it. The mercury vapor lamp operating at low pressure emit radiation of 2500 AU, while at high pressure they emit radiation about 3650 AU. Since both the emissions are in the ultraviolet region, are of no use as source of light. However, this radiation can be used to excite certain materials. When the excited molecules of these materials return to normal, they emit a radiation at a frequency different from that which caused the excitation, and thus the radiation emitted by the material may be within the visible zone so that the ultraviolet radiation are converted to light. Material which possess this property are called fluorescent. The fluorescent lamp is in the form of tube 3 to 5 cm in diameter and 5 meter to 1.5 meter long with an electrode at each end. So the fluorescent tube is, it is in the form of a tube and is 3 to 5 centimeters. Their diameter is about 3 to 5 centimeters and 5 meter to 1.5 meter long with an electrode at each end, which are in the form of coiled filament coated with an electron emitting material. The inside of the tube is coated with fluorescent powder and the operating temperature of the tube is coated with an fluorescent approximately 50 degree centigrade. No outer tube is required. A series choke for stabilizing the discharge and a shunt capacitor across the supply main or your supply terminal for improvement of power factor are used with the tube. The lagging power factor is due to the choke only. Sometimes a small capacitor of 0.05 microfarad is connected across the tube as shown in the figure 6.48. So we'll have a look at in the figure first. So this is the figure number 6.48. Here you can clearly see the circuit diagram of a fluorescent tube. So here you will find the capacitor is connected. There is also a starter. Also, there is a choke connected. So, this is the circuit diagram of a fluorescent tube. To suppress the radio interference as the tube draws non-sinusoidal current from the supply on account of the characteristics of the discharge, when the supply is switched on, the current flows through the choke, the stator, heater and the electrodes. The heater coil raises the temperature of the bimetal contacts and they separate, thereby the current through the choke is interrupted and the consequent voltage pulse of approximately 1000 volt causes the tube to strike. Once the tube strikes, the tube current flows through the stator heater and the bimetal contact remains open. So students, this kind of lamp, you should remember the circuit diagram. It is a very easy connection which I should again bring you in the screen. So here this lamp is connected with the help of a choke. There is a stator also. There is a capacitor connected also. Obviously, this capacitor is used for correcting the power factor or improving the power factor, you can say. So this diagram you should remember. Now you have fluorescent discharge lamps may be operated on a DC supply also. So they can be used in DC supplies also. This requires the use of resistive ballast for an arc stability in addition to the choke for producing the voltage pulse. The resistive ballast introduces very high power loss in the ballast. Also, the migration of the positively charged mercury ions towards the cathode results in low light output from the anode. Now for this reason, whenever the tube is to be used on DC, a reversing switch is normally used in the circuit to change the direction of the current. Normally the tube every few hours. It is usually preferred to use an inverter circuit whenever DC supply is available. The frequency is usually 10 kHz. With the advent of power transistors, this method of operation of tubes is extensively used in trains, buses and aircrafts. So there are some special purpose of source of light and other halogen lamps are there, which we will discuss in our next class. So only few, yes, there are some important topics which we will cover in our upcoming classes. So thank you students for watching.